Whoa. I've decided to have a different place to be filming this, at least from a different angle from where I usually have it. Just to be different. I don't know how often I'll do it like this, but hey, whatever. Today I'm going to talk about an article I saw. Actually, it was a week ago, honestly. Yeah, I believe it was a week ago. And it has to do with something that I might have brought up, because it is Batman related. Obviously, you already know what it is because of the title and whatnot, but there's this thing about how Heath Ledger is basically going to be in The Dark Knight Rises. Like, had he not died, he would have been in the third Batman film. Automatic guarantee, everybody knows it. And the article that I saw tried to essentially say that with a quote from Heath Ledger's sister. But what his sister said was, he loved the experience making The Dark Knight, and he wanted to play that character again. He wanted to be in the next installment, essentially, in one way or another. That is not confirmation that he was supposed to be in the film. I think that's another thing. People aren't that fond of The Dark Knight Rises, and I already made a video about that, last week. It was actually, I wanted to actually make that video for some time, honestly. But seeing that article just brought that happening when I did. And yeah, I just wanted to tell some basic stuff about Christopher Nolan and Batman. One thing you have to remember, and while I have said in some videos that while Bruce, while Nolan did think of Wave or where he would like to see Bruce Wayne to end up if he ever got to make more than one movie, he basically just stopped right there. Quit thinking of any movie to come after Batman Begins. He was gonna focus on making one movie and making it the best he could do, or best he could make. And then he did the exact same approach when doing The Dark Knight. And then when The Dark Knight Rises was happening, same thing. And, he actually wrote, he crafted a story that fit the first two movies and concluded the story that was creating. And while I don't know if his initial plan of where he ever wanted to see Bruce Wayne end up, if he did three movies, more than one movie. I have never heard it from the man himself. I've heard from his wife he had a plan of where he would like to see him end up, but that's it. Never heard anything really from Nolan about it. Perhaps we will. I don't know. I don't want to say we never will or we will. That's something to be discussed, or that's another discussion for another day. But to reiterate earlier, again, Nolan always focused on one Batman movie at a time. After he did The Prestige, which was after Batman Begins, he kind of thought about doing a sequel to Batman Begins. And he said he didn't actually set up at all a sequel. What he did was, with the Joker card at the end of Batman Begins, that was like the story in that universe. The next thing is he encounters the Joker. That's the next thing. You know, and he didn't see that as, yep, there's going to be a sequel. There's definitely going to be a sequel. He didn't. He just thought it's just a fun thing to be like, for the audience to see Batman Begins and be like, there's more to this. There's more to this story. There's more to this universe that Christopher Nolan has created. And that's what that whole ending was. It was never to be like, yep, there is going to be a sequel. Just you wait. Because he didn't think it would really happen. He didn't think he would ever do a second film. Just like he didn't really think he would do a third film. Though with the third film, people kind of make it like he planned to do another movie after The Dark Knight. And he didn't. The next thing he really wanted to do was Inception. Because he had thought about that film and had developed it over the course of 10 years. And he thought it was time, you know. He made some big movies. He made Batman Begins. He made Prestige. He made The Dark Knight. He was now fairly familiar with big budget movies. Movies that this script, this story he has now had experience with making that. And instead of going into Batman again right afterwards, he just thought, I'll do that movie that I thought about doing for a while. Then, after Inception, he then committed to doing The Dark Knight Rises. But one thing people need to know, the earliest hint of Nolan ever potentially doing the sequel to The Dark Knight and finishing out the story of Bruce Wayne that began with Batman Begins was in December of 2008, when the Blu-ray of The Dark Knight was coming out. There was an interview that Nolan had where, because people had already seen it, was like the biggest film in the entire world. Basically, everybody saw The Dark Knight. They asked him, when will the third movie come out, or is there a third? Because, you know, again, the way The Dark Knight ends, while it does, like, Batman Begins, like, where it seems like, oh, there's going to be a sequel because of how it ends. It's just that idea of there's more that could happen. There is, this is a big story, it's a big universe, and these characters in it, you'd be like, I like to see more of that, basically. That's the whole point of the way those films end. Where there's sort of a format, finality to it, and yet at the same time, it's open to where this universe is so big it can keep going. In 2008, again, now I'm getting to that point, I guess. He actually said he has written a very rough draft of what Batman 3 could be, what his Batman 3 could be, by December of 2008. So Heath Ledger had been dead for almost a year, unfortunately. He had a very rough draft of it. A third Batman movie, and not rough draft, an outline is a better word for it, a pretty basic outline of what he thought could potentially happen after the Dark Knight. And he was, though he was just getting ready to put all eggs in, that he had for another movie after the Dark Knight into Inception, because, you know, he wanted to make another movie that wasn't Batman related. And that movie, he had the idea for quite a while. And he took breaks between Batmans with The Prestige. He didn't do another Batman film. You know, he took a break. So in a way, that wasn't unusual. But the earliest you could ever say of Christopher Nolan ever thinking of making The Dark Knight Rises, the earliest you could ever pinpoint was in December of 2008, when he said he had like a very rough idea plot of what could happen. And then as he was finishing Inception, he got together with Dick Goyer and his brother, and they made up a new, another story. And The Dark Knight Rises happened, and the rest is, as they say, is history. You know, I've said I love all three films, though if I ever had to choose a favorite, I'd probably just choose The Dark Knight Rises, because I feel the story gets better with each film. And that being said, that doesn't mean I like Batman Begins any less than the other two. It just means if I had to choose, I love where the story goes. I love how the story went. And yeah, it was a good story. And it was just, it was nice also, or a good gesture on Nolan's part, not to mention the Joker, because, you know, out of respect for Heath Ledger, people act as if though he had an idea of a third film, and he really didn't. He was too busy focusing on The Dark Knight. He unfortunately passed away, Heath Ledger passed away during post-production when they were editing the film. And all of his scenes were filmed and finished. And he was too busy getting the final cut of The Dark Knight produced or finished and finalized and be able to be shipped out to theaters for that summer. So he wasn't at all thinking of a future film after The Dark Knight. That all happened once The Dark Knight was released. So Heath Ledger had been gone for quite a while at that point, and probably after doing all the promotion he need to do for the film, and he went and wrote a potential outline, a potential plot for what a third Batman film could be, before deciding, if I'm going to do another Batman movie, I'm going to do this first, because this movie, you know, is something I've had an idea for quite some time, and I want, and now is the best time, because, you know, he has Warner Brothers trust. People go see Christopher Nolan movies, people see The Dark Knight. I made $1 billion, so people will see whatever Christopher Nolan makes, Batman or not Batman. And people saw Inception and they loved it. But yeah, I just wanted to make this video because there's been this misconception that all along Christopher Nolan wanted the Joker in The Dark Knight. And because Heath Ledger passed away, he scrapped any potential way of him being the main villain or a fairly important to the film in one way or another. Though some say like the Scarecrow cameo in The Dark Knight, well, that was supposed to be the Joker, and that he would have been suited for that part. No. That's all after the fact, and that's with people who, you know, again, had so much hype and had so much expectations for The Dark Knight Rises because of The Dark Knight. They hyped it up so much it could never live up to their wildest imaginations. It could never live up to the hype that they had in their mind of where they wanted it to go and where it wasn't really going to go the way that they all wanted. But, you know, that's Nolan. He made Batman his way. And you don't have to like it. But I think in a way you could at least respect him for taking various elements from various famous comic book stories and taking bits and pieces of those stories and those elements and putting them in and showing Batman in a different way, a more realistic, kind of grounded reality. Where if Batman ever was to be real, be Christian Bale's Batman, be Heath Ledger's, Christopher Nolan's Batman would essentially be that. That would be our real-life Batman, if there ever could be a real-life Batman, a real-life Joker, Scarecrow, and Bane. You know, that's what it could that's what it could be. And props to him for doing something different from with a famous character, because in hindsight, or when looking back, it was actually, that was probably a huge, risky thing to even do. But, you know, he had a vision, he had a story he wanted to tell in each film. He took the time to make each film the way he wanted to make it. And I think in that respect, people can appreciate what he did. They may not like the Nolan interpretation, but on a technical level, on a storytelling and even directing level, you can at least respect him for that, for doing what he did. Daring to be bold in a comic book genre, a superhero genre, and essentially transcending what people thought about comic book films and superhero films. And these films are seen as those, and yet they're actually seen as more. They're crime drama thriller films, as well as comic book movies and superhero movies. You don't really hear that with any of the other interpretations of Batman. These three films seem to have more respect than those interpretations. And I'm not saying the other interpretations are bad. I mean, I love Adam West's Batman. I really enjoy the Tim Burton Batman. And I think, you know, the Ben Affleck Batman is all right. Sure, the material he has may not be the best, and he could be offered better stuff. But, you know, with what he has and what he's got, I feel he's doing the best with what he's got. Some may agree with that or disagree. Perhaps someone thinks he's the best Batman. I don't think so. As I've said, I think Christian Bale is the best Batman in Bruce Wayne. He convinces me that he would grow up because of the trauma he had seeing his parents kill in front of him, that he would grow up and channel that pain and anger that was buried in him for so long and then unleash it as Batman. I just believe that more than, you know, Michael Keaton or Ben Affleck, but again, they did a very good job with their interpretation of Batman. And with Nolan's Batman, he got the best one of them. And he also got the best Joker. And as for Catwoman, I don't know. I really like a lot of the different Catwomen. Michelle Pfeiffer was great. Anne Hathaway was great. The 60s Catwomen were amazing as well as those two. Halle Berry's wasn't good. I'm not saying that just to hate. It's just the way they did that character. I thought they didn't do her justice at all. It's like they just took the name and then just made something else out of it. Boy, I guess you don't have to have the Selena Kyle character as Catwoman because, I mean, in the 60s, there were three Catwomen, so maybe Julie Newmar was Selena Kyle, but the other two weren't. Or perhaps, you know, it was Lee Merriweather who was Selena Kyle, or maybe it was Eartha Kitt, but we don't know. They were just Catwoman. And so, yeah, they just essentially just took that name and they just made it what they made it, and it wasn't a good movie, in my opinion. It wasn't a good portrayal of the character, whereas the portrayals of the Batman and the Joker and the Nolan and Tim Burton versions were very good. Jared Leto, I didn't think, did a bad job as the Joker for what we saw, but then again, we just saw like 10 minutes or so, and he was kind of a waste, and it was just like, he's just there for the sake of having the Joker there, and I was like, in hindsight, when looking back, because I remember people, you know, were kind of bashing Suicide Squad. I was like, well, that's alright, it's a fine movie. Well, as time went on and I thought about it more, I'm just like, I'm just trying to be nice. And I really don't need to be nice, I guess. Well, certain characters in certain films, even if they're not the best, sometimes you just try to give the benefit of the doubt. Like the Joker, he was good for... The portrayal was fine, but nah, you know, he wasn't that great in the film because he didn't really have any point. Except getting Harley Quinn back. That was it. And it was like, well, okay. And their chemistry was, I mean, it was there, yet they kind of rushed and they cut out a whole lot of sections where it could have fleshed out a lot of their chemistry and the relationship. And I know some people enjoy the kind of relationship they had in that film, but I'm like, that's not the relationship at all. I mean, the Joker can be kind and sweet to Harley, yeah, but he's also horrible. He punches her and beats her, and he is not good, and that is just awful. An awful kind of relationship to ever be in. I wouldn't wish that relationship on my worst enemy, so there you go. That's just, that's horrible. And that's a horrible relationship, the comic book version and the version, the animated series, which I was never overtly fond of. I mean, it was okay, but yeah. I love the films more, personally, or live action. And I've droned on and on more than I probably should have, but the point was, Heath Ledger was not supposed to always be in the sequel to The Dark Knight. He was not always supposed to be in Batman 3. No one never foresaw the future of the franchise or that he was partaking in at that moment in time, thinking, okay, after this, there's going to be a third Batman. Because originally, Harvey Dent was supposed to be Two-Face in the main villain in the third Batman film, but they decided not to do that. They just decided to, you know, axe him in The Dark Knight, which led the way for Bane to come in and do what he did. And, that's really it. Anymore, I'd just be rambling. But, I don't know. Yeah. Kind of talk about my favorite Batmans, favorite Jokers. Didn't really say what my favorite Catwoman was, but I might say Anne Hathaway just because the Dark Knight trilogy is my favorite interpretation of Batman. I've said before, that's the kind of Batman as a kid I wanted to see. Not necessarily realistic in a way, but just that kind of story. And that kind of darkness. And yeah, Nolan got the people to do those characters justice. And, that's really all I've got to say. I'll just end it now before I continue on blathering. So, until next time, I'll see you all later.